Welcome to your new job as a journalist. Journalism used to be about reporting the happenings of the world to the common man, so he can be aware of what's going on. Not anymore. Your job as a journalist is to divide the people. Make them hate each other, so hopefully they kill one another. If they do, we will have more to report on, which will only make the people more divided. The cycle will continue forever. Welcome to your new job as a journalist. Make sure to overwhelm the common man into believing the world is a cold, harsh place. If they don't believe that the entire world is against them, we aren't doing our job right. Make sure old ladies think that the China virus is going to kill them. And make sure they think that anyone who doesn't wear their mask is the problem. Welcome to your new job as a journalist. We will pick and choose what stories we run. Only a handful of corporations run every newspaper, newscast, online news outlet, and literally every piece of news you can find today. If we don't want it to be known, we won't let it be known. Why do you think ABC killed the Epstein story in 2016? Because it was an election year. We wouldn't want that to stand in her way, would we? Welcome to your new job as a journalist. You will not make anything notable. Every story you make will cover some stupid fucking restaurant opening in town, or some event going on in the community. If you're lucky, someone will kill their family, and you will get to report it since it's in your town. That will be your legacy. You will be remembered as the person who reported a mass shooting. Is this what you wanted in life? Are you fulfilled? Are you happy? Welcome to your new job as a journalist. Now, get started.
They say you should use matches, but I'm a trashy piece of shit. I've been smoking for a long time. And I still cough. The coughing is just something that I've never been able to not do. And listen, I know how to smoke. It's not that I'm just doing this for a video. It's not just some gimmick. It's a fucking blizzard. Supposedly, whenever you're watching this, this was the blizzard on Christmas Eve, and I'm in Ohio, so as you see, you know, I'm seeing my breath. I got two jackets on here. If you can see out this window, we got some major fucking snow. But the snow didn't come down as hard as, you know, the temperature. The temperature is the real problem. It's, you know, with the wind blowing, it's like negative 20 out. And it feels shitty. It feels really fucking shitty outside. So, I kind of want to just talk about what's going on with Kobe Sucks, the other channel. A lot of you guys who only know me on this channel and know me for being Kobe Cook are surprised when they see a legitimate sort of like story time or infotainment video. A lot of people are shocked to know that, you know, I could tell a coherent story. But I figured I want to give some background to that. I mean, for one, I grew up basically saying I was going to be a journalist. I was going to be a reporter. I was going to go into news organizations. And, you know, I was going to be the best fucking journalist that, you know, Dayton has ever seen. I was going to be Jamie Simpson. Wait, he was a weatherman. Jamie Simpson is the only person in the entirety of the realm of journalism, news, all of that, that I have any sort of respect for, because he's real. Jamie Simpson is somebody's at my door. Jamie Simpson is real. He showed his real passion for the people.
Just go back to the show. No, we're not going back to the show, folks. This is a dangerous situation, okay? It's nice, right? Think about this. This was your neighborhood. I'm sick and tired of people complaining about this. Our job here is to keep people safe, and that is what we're going to do. Some of you complain that this is all about my ego. Stop, okay? Just stop right now. It's not. I'm done with you people. I really am. This is pathetic. Dangerous situation here. All right, I'm sorry I did that. It just really bothers me that we have people that don't care about other people's safety around here. That's just ridiculous.
And not only that, he's relatable. My man was arrested for drunk driving. It's fucking awesome. It's like, you know, I relate to that. And he's not really doing it anymore, and I don't know why. I feel like I trust him now more than ever. Jamie, if you're watching this, you gotta return to us, man. I speak for a lot of people when I say we miss you, and we don't care what you did. We don't care what happened. We just want you back telling us about the weather. So yeah, now I actually went to school for journalism. I went to school for all that. My official bachelor's degree is in broadcast media. And, you know, I always wanted to be able to go out there and tell a story, because I was a stupid fucking 22-year-old who was like, I'm going to do it differently. I'm going to do it right. I'm not going to have any biases. I'm not gonna have any sort of bias in my stories. My stories are gonna be straight and to the point. I feel like every journalist goes in saying that, but there isn't a journalist on this earth who doesn't have some sort of bias. Any sort of news reporter. And that realization happened to me with about 2 semesters left. And the big thing to me, the big turning point, if you will, was the death of Kobe Bryant. You know, I'm not going to lie and say I was a basketball guy. I wasn't. I don't watch basketball. I couldn't even tell you who my favorite team is, because I've never sat and watched a full game of basketball that wasn't, you know, some high school shit. You know, or somebody I'm related to, or my high school team, or some shit like that. I've never watched a NBA game. I can't even tell you what the initials for college basketball is. It just college basketball? But, I mean, there's an obvious relation with me and Kobe Bryant, because I'm Kobe. And he was Kobe. So, I've talked to my mom. I was never officially named after Kobe. You know, that's not why they named me Kobe. But I mean, the name is there because of him. You know what I mean? They weren't setting out to name their son after Kobe Bryant, but him being named Kobe was a big part of why I'm named what I am. Let me explain what happened the day of. When Kobe Bryant died. I got a push notification, as I'm sure a lot of you did, on your phone that said Kobe Bryant, you know, dead in helicopter crash. And this is coming at a time where I was having a lot of internal conflict about if I really wanted to be a reporter. You know, I had gone to school for 3 years. I'm approaching my degree to be a journalist. And I was having this internal conflict if it was something I actually want to do. And in the midst of this personal conflict, the news of Kobe Bryant's death comes out. And, you know, I was shocked. So within 30 seconds, I turn on the news. And the first thing I see is this big plane crash. Not this plane crash. This the scene of where it happened. I see the fire being put out. And people are you know, surrounding the scene, obviously. It was the scene of Kobe Bryant's death. And there was this lady standing there talking, you know, not in front of it because they couldn't get close, but nearby. And there's this cameraman who's just recording the entirety of the Kobe Bryant crash scene. And in that moment, I kind of realized, you know, if I was a journalist and something like that happened, that would have been my job. My job would have been to go record where Kobe Bryant died. And then for the rest of history, when I say, you know, I'm a journalist, I'm a camera, you know, I'm a news cameraman, people would say, well, what was your big moment? I'd have to say, oh, I recorded when Kobe, or where Kobe Bryant died at. I don't want to be known for shit like that. And that was a big moment for me to, that was the moment when I realized I didn't want to do it. And, I was too late to get out of, I couldn't switch my major at that point. I mean, I had virtually a semester and a couple of weeks left because it was winding down on my second to last semester. In my last semester, I took one class because my fucking school fucked me up. The registrar. I finished it. I went through. I went through and I got my degree. And something I don't want to fucking do. And the college I went to, I had two teachers who meant a lot to me. I've never in my life had a teacher that you know, changed my life. I know that some kids out there have that, but you know, I was one of the kids who, I never had a teacher change my life. I never had a fucking teacher mean a lot to me. The first teacher I had was he was only there for my first semester, but he would sit back and he would talk to me, and, he would shoot the shit about why I should stick to doing my creative stuff, you know. At that point I had only made Menace to Society, Trash was about to come out, a lot of teachers, I was very open with what I made, so everybody knew the Trash video was there, the Menace to Society video was there, but a lot of teachers approached me and practically said, you know, you need to purge your online content, you need to purge your accounts, you need to get rid of everything, because you don't know how bad the stuff you do is. Nobody's gonna hire you. I heard this constantly from many, many teachers. But there's this one teacher who basically told me, like, fuck what everybody else is saying. This is the shit you want to do. You're an artist. You're creative. Keep doing it. And it definitely wasn't the popular opinion amongst the teachers, but that was the one I listened to a lot. And I, you know, if you're making something and you don't know how it's, you're a little anxious at how things are going to end up, that's normal. But if you make something and then you're on the edge if you should post it or not, that's usually, at least to me, the biggest sign that you should post it. So yeah, this teacher was pushing me hardcore. He even has a copy of my trash DVD. As much as I don't like that video anymore, it's something I made, and at that point I thought it was really good. So yeah, he has a copy of it, and he watched it and was like, dude, he's like, you have something here. Keep going. On the other hand, I had this other teacher who, I kind of keep in contact with him, to this day, because, he was a really cool dude. He was really, he was smart, but he was prim and proper. He was a news reporter for, you know, many, many years, and then came to be a professor of reporting and journalism. So, like, for example, my class was, we had 5 major news stories due in our, it was like 16 weeks, and it would have to be a real news story. You would have to find something going on campus, and he would want that shit turned in as if you were for the New York Times or, you know, your local newspaper, whatever it is. He would want the who, what, when, where, why. He would want it laid out properly. And after you would turn it in, you would have to set up you would have to schedule a meeting time with him where for 40 minutes he would sit there and he would go through this entire article with you, tell you what you could have done better, tell you what to change, sit there with you as if he was your editor-in-chief. And a lot of the other students would always tell me, like, dude, he changed my entire fucking article. Nothing I wrote was the same. But for me, he never changed really anything I did. He would just tell me how to word stuff better. And at the end of it all, he told me that, and you know, I'm not just saying this because I want you guys to fucking stroke my ego, but this is really what he said to me. He said I was one of the best he had ever at reporting. And most of it's because you just fucking cover the who, what, when, where, why. Just say what the fuck happened. I mean, it really is an easy concept. You don't over-describe anything. You don't fucking need to tell all this unnecessary shit. Just say who, what, when, where, why. And give each part of the story the appropriate amounts of time it deserves. So yeah, I passed that class with flying colors. And he, at the end of class, was talking to me just like, you know, what's your plan? Were you going to go try to work? And I basically told him that I don't really want to do reporting. And he was shocked because he told me that I could easily go get a job anywhere. Not like resume stuff aside, I could easily get a job anywhere, and I could stay on reporting. I mean, he even liked, I wrote some fucking articles for Society 19 as my internship, and even though it was, I was writing articles on, like, the top 10 air fryer recipes, he said they were good, and my man was shocked, and he told me to reconsider. The other thing about reporting that I didn't like was, if you're a reporter, you're expected to, at least this is how they teach you. I know this isn't like how things are in the real world, but they teach you that you have to be unbiased, and they teach you that you're not really allowed to have an opinion on anything. I can understand in the story, right? if you're telling a news story, not to give them your fucking, this is how I feel about President Trump. Like, not to do that. I totally get that. But we had a speaker in our class. It was Letitia Perry from one of the local news stations around here. So Letitia Perry is a black woman, and she was telling us this story about how she, I forget exactly how it went, but it was along the lines of, she was trying to cover a story, and she got called the N-word. And she was expected, not only expected, but she did it, and to her credit, she's a better person than I am. She was called the N-word, hard R to her face, and she was expected to not react. And I understand that that's a good trait of a journalist, that's a good trait of a reporter, of a newsman, but I couldn't do that. Now, listen, I understand I don't really have to worry about being called the N-word, because I don't, like, you know, look at me. But if something along those lines were to happen, and I'm not saying there's really much in the sense that you could call a white dude. I mean, I'm Hawaiian, but I'm white. There's not really much you can call either a white guy or a Hawaiian that is equivalent to that of calling a black person the N-word. I'm well aware of that, but if I was put in a situation where I was called, not even just a derogatory term, but some sort of, you know, test of will against me, I wouldn't be able to handle it. And, you know, I think it's good that I'm honest with myself about it, because then if I get put in that situation, I would react the wrong way. So I graduated, did fuck all with my degree, and I started mowing lawns. And, you know, I got these side gigs. I'm, you know, I'm over at Walmart putting in some hours. I mow lawns when it's not a fucking Arctic breeze outside, but I do stuff for my money, but I still had the fire, the reporter's fire in my heart. I still had the passion to tell stories, but I didn't want to just do stories in my community. I mean, as shitty as that sounds, I really didn't give a fuck to do stories about, you know, the Rausch's restaurant in Fairborn closed today. Why? Because it was fucking disgusting. But I needed to feed that hunger. I needed to do something with some substance. So I started thinking in my real life, like, what I could make stories out of. And at that point, I was looking for FUTV. And I kind of set out to, can I tell a story about FUTV? And while it's not the most popular video on my channel, and a lot of people didn't like me for it, the FUTV video was a big turning point for me, because really everything I had made up until that FUTV video was, it was some sort of, at least my attempt at comedy. And I mean, that even includes the, you know, the trash video, the Menace to Society. I can't remember if Garbage had came out at that point, but, what? Word. We have subs. My parents went out and got subs. I could, at that point, I was trying to make stuff that was ha-ha, but I wanted to know if I could make something that people, you know, would maybe maybe learn something from, you know, the documentarian approach. I was curious if anybody would care. And, you know, that video, I got legitimate death threats from. Because a lot of people didn't like how I approached it. So, in hindsight, I guess I was wrong, but with everything I knew at the moment, I didn't put it out there. And I agree, I don't regret it. But, you know, that was kind of a turning point for me when I realized there was a little bit more to content creation than just making these ha-ha funny videos. There was a little bit more out there. And, you know, I enjoy doing it. I truly enjoy doing it. And the views I'm getting on some of the videos are really nice, too. I'm not gonna act as if I don't like those. But that doesn't mean the manifestos are gonna go anywhere. All right, that doesn't mean that you're not gonna be seeing more me doing the shit you used to seeing me doing on this channel. Those aren't going anywhere. But the Kobe Sucks channel offers me a way to get my journalistic principles and my journalistic wants and needs out there, but I get to do it on my terms. It's so fucking cold, I can't even speak right. If somebody calls me the N-word, I can go back at them. Honestly, if somebody called me the N-word, I'd probably giggle because, you know, I'm white. You know, while we're on this topic of journalism, I want to tell this, there's a story that a lot of the people who know me IRL know this story. And if you've seen the Menace to Society video, you've seen the bit, but here's a little bit more explanation. So, I was class president. I've said that in, you know, in this manifesto, right? I don't know where I am in this manifesto. And one of the big things we got to do when you're a class president, especially when you're a freshman and sophomore, is you get to work prom. You get to help set up and work prom. And I don't know if it goes for everybody's school. I think it does, but prom was for juniors and seniors. So the prom favor is something, every prom does that. They give you a little keepsake. And Fairborn did a shot glass. A fucking shot glass. Which, so it wasn't just a shot glass. It had a bunch of candy inside of it. And it had like this mesh net wrapped around it with like a gold ribbon. So, you know, here's just a picture of it right here. I got one because I worked the prom. They let me do it. So I took a picture of the shot glass and I put on my Instagram page, Fairborn. The only place that has shot glasses as prom favors. And I just thought it was a funny little joke. Thought it was a neat little thing, right? 2 days later, I have a tweet at me from Elise Coulter. That might be her name. Hi, Kobe. I'm Elise Coulter from Fuck All News. And we'd like to get in contact with you about a comment of the shot glasses given out at prom. And right then and there, I was like, oh shit. Something's about to happen. So I got on my Instagram real quick and I deleted the post. Because, I mean, all she would have really wanted me was me to like talk shit about my school. You know, Fairborn is so fucking stupid for giving us these shot glasses when I was just making a little joke. You know, I'm not gonna lie and say I wasn't like, when I saw the shot glass, I wasn't like, ooh, that's a bad idea. But I wasn't doing it to be like, look how fucking stupid Fairborn is. No, I mean, I love the city of Fairborn. So anyway, the next night, it was like the next night or the next like day or whatever, there was a actual news article that dropped about these shot glasses given out at Fair Awards Prom. And in it, they fucking quoted my post on Instagram. And I was like, ooh, okay, that's bad, right? That night, one of their top stories is a fucking, it's about the shot glasses. And in the news report, they showed my fucking tweet.
Party favors are a nice way to remember prom night. But some Fairborn parents tell us tonight the high school did their kids no favor by handing out shot glasses and souvenirs. A viewer tipped us off on Facebook, and then our Elise Coulter talked with parents and with the superintendent.
This is a picture of the shot glass filled with candy adorned with Fairborn High School's logo. It was sent to us by a student.
It was inappropriate because they're underage. They can't drink. Why give them shot glasses?
The student commented saying, Fairborn, the only place to give out shot glasses as prom favors.
Do you want your kid's school giving out a shot glass?
No. No.
Superintendent Dave Scarberry says in the 12 years he's been in charge, they've given out several different kinds of glasses, including wine, margarita, champagne, and there's never been a problem.
I think it's fine. They gave him a gift. It's a nice gift. You can drink mouthwash out of a shot glass, or you can drink whatever you would like to put in there, or you use it as a little planter.
Shot glass is a planter. I hadn't thought about that one. The district says they held an after prom program from 11:30 until 3:30 a.m. to keep kids from drinking or planting. 280 students attended. 40 good parents volunteered.
They showed my goddamn tweet on the news. Not to mention, they also showed my Instagram post, the picture of it with my tiny ass hands holding the fucking shot glass. You know, I'm sitting there watching the news, just like jaw on the floor. Because at this point, I was fucking 15. I mean, not if that. And I'm just like, my jaw is dropped looking at this news report. And, so I walked out into the living room and I was like, Mom, Dad, you guys have to see this. So I pull it up on the TV, I rewind it, and I just show it. And my parents' jaw are both on the floor. And we just all look at each other. I was like, what do we do? And we realize there's really nothing we can do. I mean, my fucking tweet got a news story. And so in the post, they censored my name. I mean, for one, I was a minor, but for two, I really don't think not that you're not allowed to, but I don't think news organizations will post usernames and stuff like that. So I went to school and everybody's talking about the shot glass controversy. And everybody was trying to figure out who sent this goddamn tweet. And it would have been really easy for me to just kind of let it slide. Not say anything. You know, I had been deleted. Nobody really looked at my Instagram anyway. I was a fucking loner. So, you know, nobody saw it other than my little handful of outcasts I sat at lunch with. But I kind of wanted the attention. I can't lie. So I told everybody I was me. And I had the screenshots to prove it. And, you know, 95% of people who saw it for the comedy that it was. 95% of people saw it just as hilarious, and a lot of people are like, dude, you were on the news, that's awesome, high five, can I get your autograph? But there was a couple of people who took problems with my tweets because they saw it as me ripping my city. And there was even one kid that went as far as to like approach me, like, you're a fucking bitch for fucking doing this, blah blah blah, you're a fucking little bitch, like getting at me. And I'm like, all right, like, whatever you think, bro. My tweet was on the news. Yours wasn't. And then, at the end of the day, our main principal was there. Or our main principal was in the hallway. And I happened to just stroll on by. And she stopped me. And she was like, you sent that tweet, didn't you? And I wasn't going to lie to her. I said, I did. And, you know, she straight up told me, she was like, look, we're not mad at you. We're not going to get you in trouble. Nothing is going to happen because you sent out that tweet. You know, it's nothing that you should worry that, you know, you're going to get in trouble for. And I mean, not that I was, but that was a little bit of a relief because, you know, she wasn't mad that I sent it out. She just said, you know, next time remember that your tweets and anything you post online might get a reaction from people. And, you know, I've remembered that since then, you know, and that's something that was 10 years ago, roughly. I've kept that in my heart since then. But, you know, my final thoughts on the whole thing is just because you want to do something when you're 15 doesn't mean when you're 22 and you're having second thoughts mean that you have to keep doing it. You can be honest with yourself. You can be honest when it's time to give something up. Don't be afraid to either. Don't be afraid to just say, you know, I thought I wanted this, but now I don't anymore. Don't be afraid it's not even giving up. Don't be afraid to turn back and try something else. Anybody who's telling you, you need to be this, or you have to do this to have a good life, you have to do this to be happy, you have to do this to be successful, don't listen to them. Only you know what is good for you. Only you know what is right for you. And only you know what will make you happy. And what anyone else thinks doesn't fucking matter. If you want to do something, do it. Because at the end of the day, you always wonder what could have been. I guess that's going to be it for this manifesto. Thanks for joining me. And I'll see you in the next one. Tell me where you want your